everybody. I'm Peter Travers, and this is Popcorn, where we tell you what is happening at the movies. And there's a movie happening called The Impossible that puts its star, Naomi Watts, in lots of predicaments. I'm not going to say any more because Naomi Watts is here.
Hello.
Welcome.
Hi.
Welcome. So this, I would look at this movie, which has a visceral effect, but it also has an emotional effect. I would look at this as not the easiest job you ever took on.
Definitely not. Definitely not. Physically, emotionally, yeah, it definitely was a big one.
It's based on a true story.
Yeah.
Which always, when I see that on a movie, I go, uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah. Based on a true story?
Yeah,
or
no,
is it a true
is
story?
Blow by okay. blow, yeah. a true story. Everything that she and her, each member of her family went through was all the truth from her perspective.
But your character, Maria, who yeah. is she? She's on vacation with her husband yeah. and family.
Yeah, in Khao Lak in Thailand. Mm-hmm. And we shot exactly where they were staying. She's a ex-doctor. She's got three boys. And they're just having their summer... I mean, a vacation from the winter, it took place. The tsunami took place, and then suddenly they're all split apart and trying to find each other.
You and McGregor playing your
husband, yeah,
and this remarkable Tom Holland who plays your eldest son.
I mean, Juan Antonio got incredible performances mm-hmm. from each actor, I think. And he did a lot, extensive searching for the actors, for the little ones, and mm-hmm. two of them had never acted before, the little boys. Mm-hmm. Tom had the Billy Elliot experience, and you saw what was on screen, but even off screen, day after day, would blow me away with just this incredible, for lack of a better word, instrument. And he just went to every single place you can imagine.
And going to those places, though, and I want to ask you about how this was done. I mean, because you guys get battered around
yeah.
by this. I know it wasn't a real tsunami that was happening, but what were you shooting in a tank? What
we
was going on?
We shot in water tanks for 6 weeks. Five of those weeks was the above water, mm-hmm. or trying to stay above water. Now, working with water, we know, is difficult. But once you're there, you realize just how difficult it is. And we shot in Alicante in Spain, which is like they have this large water tank. And they had it all worked out. We were fixed into these sort of giant flower pots. We would anchor ourselves in. The current is pushing us. Another current is coming against us. We have side pumps and then garbage and debris and all kinds of things being thrown at us. Tom loved it. He thought it was like going to the water park every day.
And why am I sensing that it wasn't the same feeling that you were getting?
Not so much yeah. for me. Well, he's 14 mm-hmm. and he's an athlete and, you know, mm-hmm. it's fun for him. But for me, I didn't enjoy it. And I also have fear of the water, going back to a bad experience in my teenage years. But I'm thankful that they made the decision, and actually it was a decision that was made for them because they didn't have the money to do CGI, and everything was done with models. But I'm thankful because had we have been on a green backdrop, mm-hmm. Arms flailing about, calling each other's names, it would have been a different performance. We did have a technical issue with the underwater stuff, which completely freaked me out. And that was, the underwater stuff is always going to be more scary. We would be anchored in, have weights on our legs so we, you know, didn't float to the top. You had your oxygen before you roll and then they say action and you let it go. And the chair starts to spin. And you, and then the camera's going around you. And then when you're fully out of breath, you have to release your belt that's kept you in, and you come to the top. And of course, you know, you want to be a good sport and keep the shot going as long as possible. And in this case, I was stretched to my limit, and then I wanted to get out, but I couldn't get out. And then the chair actually started spinning the other way. And I'm thinking, oh my God, is the director trying to get extra fear out of me or something?
Extra fear.
Because he's definitely got it.
My SAG card doesn't say that there's extra fear.
Specialty.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah, here's what I do.
So, and I came to the top in an absolute state, absolutely full of panic and rage.
What are you doing to me?
But it turns out it was a technical problem. They were trying to shut it off, but
that's what they all say. It's a technical problem, but you know, they did get the extra fear
they
out
did,
of you.
They did. They did.
You don't take the easy way out a lot. I don't see you in many little tiny movies in which you just sit in a library and discuss that you were reading Chekhov. You're doing King Kong and you're working on this massive scale. And
I don't know. I'd like to be in one of those movies.
Would you?
I would.
A little Chekhov?
Something lighter and slower or easier. I don't know.
Even The Painted Veil, you're just like all over China, you know. And it doesn't seem to be easy. The movies always work better.
Well, I just think I want to be in films that make people think a bit and that stay with them. And I think certainly Mulholland Drive is one to this day. You know, even though it wasn't nominated for an Oscar or anything, people still talk about that film.
The scene of the many in that movie that really gets me is your audition scene.
Yeah.
Which you do with Chad Everett, where we've seen you already work out the lines. And I can't remember the specific line, but it's like, get out of here or I'll kill you.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly that, or something like that.
And you have to read it in 40 different variations.
And that's why it works so well, because it's set up with that bad rehearsal with her friend, and then suddenly there's magic in the room.
I can call my dad.
With bad, bad, bad dialogue. And it's what, you know, every time you look at a script for the first time, you say, there's my part. That's the whole part right there. This is the reason I'm going to do this movie. And it can just happen all in one scene. And that was that scene. I just, you know, literally was turning the pages and then went,
ooh. What is the David Lynch experience like?
It's brilliant. You just want to, you just lap it up. And I wish I'd had a second one.
You did have a little
of a debt to pay.
Yes, a debt to pay.
Which was not
That's
such
the way it was.
I had to walk around in hot lights with a bunny head and a fur suit on that wasn't properly. Exactly. Yes. Listen, if you owe someone, you pay back.
You definitely do it. But, you know, meeting him, anybody that does, I'm always, I'm struck by it. He's almost like has a country voice.
Yeah.
And it's...
It's so the opposite wide-eyed. Of what you think he would be like when you read his material and see his films. It's sort of shocking. It's like, how is this sort of dark, twisted stuff coming out of that mind? But he's just a joy, that man. I love, love, love him.
Did you just finish the Princess Diana?
Yes. It was a story that was going to be told, and I just felt like that she was a fascinating woman. I mean, it's delicate because her boys are still around, and